After waiting several hours, the time has come.
Forgive me, Father, for I have sinned.
Good afternoon, everyone. This is 287. And to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, I hope you're having a happy and blessed Sabbath. Now, today I'm going to spend some time talking about sin. I'm going to try and break it down at a bunch of different levels, such as where it comes from, what it is, what's at the root of it all, just several different aspects that we all need to understand. We need to quit looking at sin in a frivolous manner and really understand the seriousness of it and what it is and what we can do about it. So with that being said, we're going to jump right in. Now, when we tell our children, I'm talking little children, we tell them not to do something or don't touch something or don't go there, and we turn our backs, and every little fiber in their body drives them, that desire is so much in them to do it that they proceed to do it, they're committing total disobedience, sin against what we've told them not to do. But the question is not so much that. The question is, what is this drive, this desire to commit this disobedience comes from? We have to understand these things so that we can deal with it at a different level. The Father purpose for all of us, all of mankind, that we would live in submission to Him and have all our needs met, and that we would live our lives full of joy and peace and confidence and assurance, with us fulfilling the purpose of our lives that He had created us for. But what? Something happened. And we all know what happened. Adam and Eve lost everything that the Father provided for them. Thus, we lost everything because it was provided for us also. And as a result, we have all suffered. Now look, our attitudes about sin as believers, and I'm talking as believers, is a sad position at best. We joke about it. As believers, we should be up in arms about sin, no matter what kind of sin it is. But our society has become more and more open about it, about doing it, about putting it in our face. Look, believers are becoming weaker and weaker. Sin is becoming bolder and bolder. Look, we tolerate things in our lives that 20 years ago we would have been jumping up and down about, screaming that it's sin. Now, the truth about this is that sin has gained the upper hand in our society. You know, because believers have become more fearful and more intimidated about making a stand, because what? Society is becoming stronger in its position to support sin at every level. So we have become weaker and more afraid to have a position to be against it and be outwardly against it. We're becoming more apathetic in seeing sin all around us. Look, the nature of sin just continues to rise with no resistance or very little resistance from believers. Sin is nothing to laugh about. We laugh about it, we joke about it, but I'm telling you, Scripture says nothing about laughing about sin, joking about it, or saying anything frivolous about it. Romans 5:12. Go with me to Romans 5:12. Romans 5:12 reads, "Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned." So think about that. By one man sin entered the world. Genesis 3:6. And by death, sin. 1 Corinthians 15:21. So death spreads to all men because all have sinned. Now, how is this possible? How have all sinned when really we see only Adam and Eve sin? So now we're going to get into some truths about sin so that you can understand what it's all about. Now, first, we're going to get into the origin of sin. The origin of sin wasn't in the Garden of Eden. Sin originated in heaven. Ezekiel and Isaiah talk about it, and we'll get there in a second. But Satan, he is the one. He is the originator of sin, and he gives the first confession of sin, and we're going to get into that. This is at the heart and core of all sin, Satan and his confession. Now, at its core, sin is nothing more than the essence of independence. It's that attitude of, I will do what I choose to do, in spite of what the Father says. I will act the way I want, when I want. I will get my needs met when, where, and how I want to. Go with me to Isaiah 14, and we're going to read 13 and 14. 13 reads, it says, For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. That is the first confession of sin from Satan. And if you notice, it was all about I want. This is sin. This is why Satan is a fallen angel, because he committed a rebellion against the Heavenly Father in spite of what the Father's words were. Now, he chose to act independent of the Father, to be equal with him, if not superior than him. So, all sin today begins when we begin with the I will. I is a very dangerous thing, because we have to understand that we may be committing sin when we start saying I will meet my own needs, I will do what I choose, I will be free of anyone's restraints, I will be free of the Father's restraints, I will do what I please. When we start getting into the eyes, we start treading on that independent rebellion from the Father, not just the individuals that we usually voicing these concerns too. So you have to ask your question, am I like that? Or do I know someone like that? Do you have children like that? Do you have a husband like that? Do you have a wife like that? That I will, I want, I won't listen to, I'm gonna do what I wanna do, that kind of person. If you think about it, all that I-ing usually is followed by rebellious statements. So we have to be careful not to fall in that type of selfishness, because what we're creating is an independence separate from the Father, not just who we're voicing those types of statements to. Now, Adam and Eve, they had everything. Their Father had provided for all their desires. But instead of waiting on Him and choosing His way, what happened? Eve acted independently. Remember that independence gets us in trouble. She acted independently of the Father. She acted independently of her husband. And she chose to do what? She chose to gain knowledge independent of the Father to satisfy her appetite independent of Him, and end up costing her husband, and all of us everything. So remember, the nature of sin is this. If you act independently of the Heavenly Father, eventually you're going to lose it all. Now, the world doesn't believe this, but Eve offered to Adam and he sinned. And we have Satan fallen in heaven, and then we have Satan in the Garden of Eden, Satan tempting Eve, and then Eve offering to Adam. And then when Adam sinned, this is what happened. Go with me to Romans 5:12. Now, Romans 5:12 reads, it says, Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passeth upon all men, for all have sinned. Remember, I started with that. That is what happened when Adam sinned. These things entered into the world for all of us. So, the very principle of sin entered into the world. Now, Adam is the father of the whole human race. Just like your children come from you, and you come from your parents, if we follow the lineage all the way back, we get to Adam and Eve. They are the parents of the whole human race. So what happens when you poison the head spring all the way down, everything becomes poison. Adam and Eve brought sin into the world, and that sin has filtered all the way down through mankind. So we all have what this principle of sin in us, thanks to our parents. It's just no different than even today, you can pass disease and sickness on to your children. If you're poisoned, they can be poisoned. If you're an alcoholic, you can give birth to alcoholic children. If you're a drug addict, you can give birth to drug-induced children. We can poison the head and it filters down. So don't be misled. This is why we say, well, we're born into sin. We're all of sin because we all have that principal nature of sin in us thanks to our first two parents. Now, sinning is natural and normal for an unbeliever. It's just natural and normal. And so what is the nature of sin? The nature of sin is something that we laugh about, we joke about it, we rationalize it, we accept it as a way of life. We say, oh, well, that's just how it is. We tolerate things in our lives that we know are against the Heavenly Father. And sin is nothing more than rebellion against the Heavenly Father. It is straight, total rebellion against Him and His laws. All sin, not just this or that, all sin. If He says it's sin, it is sin, and it's rebellion. Look, if we indulge in it at any level to get our needs met in any fashion or with any motive whatsoever, it's an act of rebellion against Him. It's us saying that, I know you said this, but I'm going to do that, irregardless of what He said, no matter what the sin may be. You know, it could be cheating, murder, adultery, even gossip. Yes, gossip is a sin. Why is the church weak, His people? Why are they weak? Why aren't His people on the move? Why is society falling apart? Is this because of Satan, or is it because we have tolerated so much sin in our lives that the power to resist it is absent? It's very minimal at best. The power to resist sin is getting weaker and weaker. Like I said, sin rises, and it's rising. We joke about it, we rationalize it, and it just continues to grow. Now, if you don't believe that sin is rebellion against the Father, look at 1 Samuel 15:23. It says that rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. And then in Proverbs 17:11, it says, an evil man seeketh only rebellion. So we're being told specifically that sin is rebellion against the Father. Now in 1 John 1, go with me there. We're going to start with verse 8. We're going to read 8, 9, and 10. 1 John 1, it reads, it says, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And then verse 10 reads, if we say that we have not sinned, we make Him a liar, and His word is not in us. Now understand this. In verse 8, it says that it's essentially saying that we are born. Listen, we are born with a sin nature in us. That's why it reads, if we say that we have no sin, so apparently we have sin. We were born with that sin. Remember, from Adam bringing it into the world, him and Eve, they brought that nature, the sin nature, in us all the way down. So we were born in that. So it is the culprit and it is the root that springs forth all the fruit of sin, especially in unbelievers. It's constantly bearing that fruit. So go with me to 2 Peter 1:4. 2 Peter 1:4. Now, once we're saved, something happens to that old sin nature that we're born with. Look, we become partakers of the divine nature, His nature. And that does something to us. 1 Peter 1:4, it reads, it says, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. So, like I said, once you become saved, you become a partaker of that divine nature. Now, don't ever be misled to think that just because you are a partaker of this divine nature now that you have nothing to do. See, you can have it, and then if you don't act upon it, it serves no purpose because it does nothing for you. So, there are plenty of people running around saying they're saved and just as lost as ever. Now, this doesn't mean that there's nothing of sin left in us. Read Romans 7. It tells us that sin remains in our fleshly bodies. It remains in us, in our core, because we were born with it. But that divine nature is that power to be able to fight it and defend ourselves against it. But we're still in these fleshly bodies, so it's always going to be there. Now, like I said, many who say they're saved, they are still lost. They go to church, they've been baptized, sprinkled, what have you. But they have never dealt with that nature, that sin nature in them. I'm sure every one of you know someone who's been saved, and they're just as sinful as ever. But yet, they claim that they've been saved, and they pretend or outwardly say that they're a different person. But because they've never dealt with that sin nature in them, being partakers of that divine nature has done nothing for them. So when you're still in this sin, what you are an unbeliever. An unbeliever has not partaken of the divine nature and done anything with it. But more than that, sin is a separator. It separates us from the Heavenly Father. We have the nature of the Father within us. Look, we must be redeemed, born again, and become a partaker of the divine nature and allow it to work in us. This is what separates believers from unbelievers, not just being saved. If you do nothing with it, it does nothing for you. We have the nature of the Father Himself in us. That's what the divine nature is. And this is what gives us that desire to be obedient to Him and to walk holy or upright before Him. So at times we may still wrestle with that flesh, but because we have that divine nature in us, it will work with us to subdue that. Look, we live in a world that is ungodly, in the midst of satanic powers, and in these fleshly bodies that still have a sin nature within them. But if we're born again, we have that spiritual ability through the Holy Spirit, or set apart spirit, to overcome sin. Remember, it's called the divine nature. And until then, there's nothing we can do to overcome sin. Not of our own power, but plenty try. Look, we can make changes in our lives, but we do this. But unbelievers do this through motivation and through situations. If the doctor says, if you don't stop this, you're going to die. People will make changes sometimes. They make changes about this and about that. But the sin still dominates their life because they don't have the divine nature about them. Sin is a blinder. It blinds you. Go with me to 2 Corinthians 4. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 4 reads, it says, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine into them. Go with me to 2 Corinthians 4, and we're going to read verses 3 and 4. Starting with 3, it reads, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine into them. Look, they are blinded from the truth. They can't discern it. They can't understand it. Go with me to 1 Corinthians 2:14. 1 Corinthians 2:14 reads, it says, but the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. So when people who are unbelievers want to debate with you and argue with you and fight with you about Scripture, The word says that it's foolishness to them. They are blinded to the truth. These things have to be spiritually discerned. And if they don't have that divine nature in them, you're wasting your time, because they're not going to get it anyway. The Father will not allow you to understand His word if you are not a believer partaking in that divine nature. There's just no way. They cannot perceive it and understand anything which only the Spirit of the Father has power over. They lack the nature in them because they have rejected the Spirit of the Father. They are blinded. They are separated in that area. A blinded man or woman is materialistic. They're rationalistic because what? They choose to live in sin, and this is what they do. They spend his or her life and their time gaining, grabbing, possessing, securing, experiencing. The lost man or woman spends their life trying to regain everything Adam and Eve lost for us in the Garden of Eden. Remember, they had everything and lost it. So a lost individual spends their life trying to regain everything that was lost. The peace, the joy, the happiness, experience, possessions, status, etc. through their own power. That's the problem. They're trying to do it through their own power. It is hopeless. It is futile. And they spend their life chasing stuff, status, fortune, as if it was a curse. I mean, there's no way to stop them. They want, and they're after everything. They're after gain and all these things because they reject the Father. They're blinded to the reality of it. But the thing they need to understand, but they can't, it may just be that it's the set apart Spirit, the Holy Spirit, convicting them, trying to get them to realize that their need is of the Father. And at some point, some get it, and at other points, some don't. But they'll spend their whole life striving with all this determination after these things to fulfill an empty life. And some may never come to the truth and realize that they've spent their whole life chasing something that they can't attain. And then in the end, they will have to answer to all these things. You can't complete that which only the Father has the answer to. You must live your life for Him to receive the peace to be able to rise above the principle of sin that is in all of us. Even with the divine nature in believers, sin still gives us all a hard time. So with that, remember, the Heavenly Father doesn't call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is 2 Base 7.